there's wax on the podium from the Christmas. I don't. Oh. This wasn't even in there. Okay. Somehow the candles made it in here too. So I feel like this is like a really bad wedding. Like everyone's on the side of the room. Just kidding. I'm just kidding. Sorry. Preacher problems, I guess. All right, I see a couple of new faces here, so I just want to say welcome to you if this is either your first time here or maybe I haven't seen you before and I just didn't notice you. Either way, welcome. I'm super, super glad that you're here. Just to make sure no one's offended, Merry Christmas, Happy New Year's, and I hope it's a great one as we go into this next year. But here's what we're going to do for a couple of minutes. We're going to pray here in a moment. We're going to pray for specifically like we do every week for our worship team as they go lead in our middle school ministry with our younger brothers and sisters in Christ there. And then we're going to pray also just for our hearts as we get ready for this sermon, that God would speak to us through his word. And then on top of all of that, then we'll get started and we will jump into our sermon text today. So let's just spend a couple of moments praying and then we'll go from there. So why don't you just bow your heads with me. Father in heaven, as we're going to see in our text today, we want to start off this year by giving you thanks. Father, you have been, as we just sung, very, very good to us. You have been kind and generous and gracious and merciful towards us through your son, Jesus. Father, you supply us with everything that we need. You provide to us the very breath in our lungs, the very ability to think and to live in the bodies that we live in, Father. And so, Father, I just pray that our minds would not lose sight of that, that we would be perhaps even more so this year, more aware of how good and how gracious and how kind you've been to us. So, Father, would you continue as you do in your character to extend grace to us, especially in this time as we open up your word? Father, would you make it clear to us? Would you help me to speak clearly, as well as would you help us to be able to, Father, see and to kind of draw out and to apply to our lives what your word has to say. Father, we pray as well for our worship team as they go and lead worship for our younger brothers and sisters in Christ in the middle school ministry. Father, we pray that their time of worship would be a time where they get to also, Father, celebrate and praise you for who you are, Father, and for what you have done. Father, be reminded of your name and who you are. So, Father, we just pray all of these things. You just pray that you would be with us now as we enter into this time of opening up your word. We pray this all in Christ's name. Amen. Amen. All right. So today we kind of find ourselves in, I guess I'm self-proclaiming it, an awkward spot because we're like right between two series. So we obviously just got done with our Advent series, celebrating Christmas and preparing our hearts to celebrate the fact that Jesus came for the first time, the first Advent, and how that kind of then draws out for us this longing for Jesus then to return a second time when he would come to finally make all things new. And so we wrap that up, and that doesn't mean that now like that's over and we're like, cool, Christmas is over and done with. Like, we should still, in all of those things, celebrate and think through this reality that Jesus has come and what that means now for our relationship with him. But we're wrapping that up, and then next week we're going to start a new series called Sticks and Stones, where we're going to be kind of talking about how our words are really, really important. Our words have the ability to do a lot of good, as well as to create a lot of harm and a lot of hurt in other people's lives, and how then in a way we're going to connect that to how Jesus has come into the world to be the word, and that we are supposed to be people of the word. So we're kind of stuck right in between those two things, and so we'll get to that stuff next week. But we're here, it's January 2nd, and I hate to be the guy, I guess, or the pastor who's like, you know, let's do a sermon about New Year's, but I thought it would kind of be fitting, and I don't have a better second option. So in all seriousness, I think it'll be a good moment for us just to pause and to think through. It's as good a moment as any to kind of stop and to think through, man, like what does a new year really even mean? Like, what is it? What is it not? What can we draw from it that would be helpful? And what are some things that we should leave by like the wayside as we kind of go into the rest of this year? And so in all of that, we kind of know how it goes, right? Like, you get to the end of the year, and then the New Year's happens, the ball drops, whatever it is, and now it's like, okay, great, like it's time to come up with resolutions and with goals and aspirations, and it's kind of like this long, like running joke. because like we probably crushed it for some of you guys because you walked in and you're like, I'm going to eat better this year. And we got you donuts. We're like, we are here for your sanctification. That's why we brought the donuts. You got some fitness goals and you're like, man, like I think I heard David say, he's like, I'm not looking at the donuts. I'm not going to look at the donuts. They're coming for you. They'll be out there when you get back. So there's that part of it. Maybe it's like, okay, maybe in all seriousness, you're like, I want to grow in my relationship with God this year. I'm going to start this new Bible reading plan. And like, you already missed the second day of reading today because you woke up late and you're like, oh, I failed. Like, how am I going to recover from missing this day and the rest of it? And like, I think it's interesting watching it happen over and over again that like, you know, people will put in like a solid 2 weeks of work and they're just like, meh. Like, I'm good. Like, I'm just going to go back to what I was doing the year before. But it also then becomes this whole like marketing thing. Like every business is like, like this is the time to get a gym membership, like all the prices super low. And then all these kind of things. It's a whole thing. It's part of it is like a money-making scheme in the world, as well as just this kind of, how would I put it? Like, it's almost like a king of wishful thinking approach to how like change actually happens in our lives, that we think, oh, because we move from one day in the calendar to another, that all of a sudden things are gonna become easier to change, or maybe it's an emotional high. There's all these things that happen when we get to this time of year. And I think like what we need to kind of focus in on here is not necessarily all the stuff that we're hearing in the world around us, but let's obviously look to God's word and see what God's word has to say. Not necessarily about New Year's. I don't think it actually says anything about specifically about the time of New Year's, but what God's wisdom and his word actually has to say about how we should navigate through seasons of life such as this. And so let me just clarify something. Like, I'm not against goals and aspirations and resolutions, but I think something I've noticed that there's typically a gap between two things when it comes to resolutions and goals and New Year's stuff like that. The on one side, we have this ideal and we have this thing that we want to pursue, right? So it could be a really, really good and godly thing, like I want to grow in my relationship with God this year. Or it could be something maybe less spiritual. So it's like, I want to work out 3 or 4 times a week, or I want to eat healthier. Or I think those are all good things. You should pursue those things. Those are good. You should take care of your body. But there's this ideal of like, I want to pursue these things. And then there's like, okay, great. I'm going to come up with a plan. And so like we download, like 80 different Bible reading plans, so that we have backups on the backups. Or it's like, great, like, like I crushed like 8 CrossFit workouts yesterday. And it's like, cool, that's not going to help. You're just going to hurt tomorrow. Like, and we just have this plan and then we have this ideal. And I think what we miss is the most important part, which is what's in the middle, which is our hearts. Our hearts are like think of a door hinge. Like they're the hearts are the thing that kind of swivels that makes the two things possible. That the only way that we can actually achieve the ideal, the thing that we're pursuing, is if our hearts change. And so then maybe the plan that we have is the thing that's gonna help us to get to that, and vice versa, it goes either way. But I think we miss our hearts and we miss kind of change and realizing that when we're really talking about doing something different than how we were doing it before, we're talking about changing our hearts. We're talking about reforming how we think and what we love and what our desires are. And so that's really what the question is then. I think that's the question that we need to think through and you guys need to think through as well as myself, as we go into this, this moment during the year where we're thinking about, man, like what happened last year? How can I change those things? Or I don't want to do that anymore. I don't want to do those things I did last year. I want to do something different this year. What we're really, really talking about at the end of the day is heart change. We're talking about how do we change our hearts? How do we change our desires? How do we change what's going on inside of our hearts and our minds when it comes to pursuing and doing these maybe new and different things that we want to do to hopefully help us to become like people who look more like Christ. And so here's the really cool thing about God's word. God's word is applicable to every scenario in our lives. And so I could have picked this passage or a variety of other passages and applied it to this moment and it would fit because that's what God's word does. And it's this living thing that speaks to us. And so we're going to open up to Psalm 16. Either you can open up your Bible. If you just like open up your Bible like halfway, like typically Psalms is right there. Psalm chapter 16. And we're going to look at that, read it, unpack it, kind of just like slowly walk through it almost in the same way that you would just read your Bible on a regular day. And I want to draw out some things from Psalm 16 as we go through this. And hopefully then apply some of those things to our hearts and to our lives. Okay, great. It's up there. I don't have the clicker. So you're in control back there. Thank you. Okay, so let me just give a quick summary before we read of kind of where we're going. What we're going to look at and what we're going to kind of pull out of Psalm 16 is that I'm typically not the guy who does like the whole alliteration thing where it's like, here's four words that start with the same letter that help you to remember it. But I did that today, so sorry. So what we're going to look at is we're going to see what we're going to see in this psalm is that there's a prayer that gives a perspective which leads to a purpose. There's a prayer that gives a perspective which leads to a purpose. And I think those are simply just going to be the three ways that we unpack this. We're going to look at how David, he prays a prayer, he makes a specific request, and in that, then he is then reorienting and changing the perspective that he has in this moment of difficulty that he's in. That's the context of what he's writing this passage of scripture. He's in a difficult time, and he's trying to change his perspective, and then it renews his purpose. It renews, okay, what's the next step coming out of this now? And I think all of this is really helpful for this moment that we are in at the moment. So it's not going to be on the screens. It's just open it either on your Bible or on your phone or something like that. And then we're going to read Psalm 16 together, and then we'll jump into the rest of the message. So this is what Psalm 16 says. It says, "Preserve me, O God, for in you I take refuge. I say to the Lord, you are my Lord. I have no good apart from you. And as for the saints in the land, they are the excellent ones in whom is all my delight. The sorrow of those who run after another God shall multiply. Their drink offerings of blood I will not pour out or take their names on my lips." And you're probably like, dude, what are we talking about? We'll come back and we'll explain that. Don't worry. That's an interesting verse in this passage. So verse 5, "The Lord is my chosen portion and my cup. You hold my lot. The lions have fallen for me in pleasant places, and indeed I have a beautiful inheritance. I bless the Lord who gives me counsel, and in the night also my heart instructs me. I've set the Lord always before me because he is at my right hand. I shall not be shaken. Therefore, my heart is glad and my whole being rejoices. My flesh also dwells secure, for you will not abandon my soul to Sheol," which is just another word for unto death, "or let your Holy One see corruption. You make known to me the path of life, and in your presence there is fullness of joy, and at your right hand are pleasures forevermore." And so David writes this psalm, as you see in the very, very first verse. He calls it a miktam, which essentially is just, I think it's a designation for a prayer written in silence, meaning that David's in the middle of a difficult season right now when he's writing this, and he can't yet pray this prayer out loud. And so he's writing it down, maybe in the same way that you and I would journal something down to say, man, I'm having a tough moment, and I gotta focus in and get my mind straight and get my mind thinking about the things of the Lord. And that's what he's doing here, and that's why he wrote this. So in a way, this whole, obviously, psalm in and of itself is a prayer, but I think there's a very specific request that David makes in the first two verses here. And so obviously, let's look at this first part called essentially a prayer, or the prayer that we see in the first four verses. He says, "Preserve me, O God, for in you I take refuge." Now, a lot of us, like when we hear the word preserve, we don't typically think of, no one necessarily walks around saying, man, like, I hope my parents preserve me today. Like when you think of preservatives, you're thinking of like either something that you put on a sandwich or something that you put in food so that it doesn't go bad. But this word that David uses here is this word that it's essentially it means like keep me or guard me or protect me. It says essentially protect me, guard me, keep me, O God, for in you I take refuge. Meaning, essentially, this prayer that David makes as he humbles himself and he says, God, you are my safe place. So a refuge, like do any of you guys know what a refuge is? Sweet, solid, one hand in the back. Thank you very much. A refuge is like a fortress, right? It's a place of protection. So think of, you know, back to medieval times when there's a big castle with all these walls and all this stuff like that. And like, and if you're a smart person, you say, cool, I'm gonna live inside of the walls so that enemies who are coming in cannot get to me. And so this refuge is like this mighty fortress. It's this big defensible position. And David is humbling himself and he's saying, I'm going to rest here. I'm going to rest in the refuge of God. And he says to God, oh God, preserve me, oh God, for in you I take refuge. And then he goes on to say, I say to the Lord, in a way he kind of has this conversation with himself. He's telling himself, he's instructing himself what to say. He says, you are my Lord and I have no good apart from you. Another kind of very weirdly worded sentence here. But he uses, and this is the interesting part, he uses three different names of God in this one sentence. So at least in verse one, he says, preserve me, O God. So O God is one way to say God. In verse two, he says, I say to the Lord. So if you look in your Bibles, is it all capitalized? Is it like four capital letters? Yes, yes. Okay, thanks, Meg. Meg's the only one reading. There is four capital letters, which is in our Bibles is the way of signifying that the name that they're using here is Yahweh. So that's how they essentially show it in the English text. And then he says, you are my Lord, which I believe when you go to the Hebrew, it says Elohim, which is another way to refer to God. And so what's interesting here is that David is reminding himself of the kind of refuge that God is. That we live in a world where lots of people go to many other different things and kinds of refuges to find hope, many other different things to find a place of protection or the thing that they're gonna find their hope in. But he's saying, I'm not running to any of those things, and we'll see that how that's explained in the text in a little bit. I'm not running to any of those things, I'm running to God, but I'm not just running to any God, I'm running to the God who is above all, Yahweh, the one who is transcendent over all. And then he says, you are my Lord. And actually, sorry, I said this incorrectly earlier, but this, when he says Lord, he's saying, it's the same thing that actually Jackson just shared. Where he says, you are my Adonai, which is a much more closer relational way of saying God's name. And he's saying, so he's painting this picture of like, God, you are this God who is strong and above and over all people. But even though you are above all things, you are transcendent, you are my Lord, my Adonai, my protector. So he goes from the transcendent to the very personal and relational. He says, you are my Lord, I have no good apart from you. In other words, saying, everything that I have in my life that is good is from God. Everything that I have in my life is a blessing from God. It's very similar in a way to the language that we see in Psalm 23:1, where it says like, the Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. It's a similar kind of phrase there. We're saying, I have no good apart from you, God. God, everything in my life is from you. You have blessed me with all of these things. I'm reminding myself, God, in this moment of difficulty, that the things that are good in my life come from you. That everything that I have in my life is from you. And so then he goes on to here in the next couple of verses to unpack then this. He kind of sets up two different groups of people. And so in verse three, this is where part of the psalm gets a little bit confusing. He says, as for the saints in the land, they are the excellent ones in whom is all my delight. So he's referring to this other group of people and he's saying, hey, and it's really more of an address. If you go down to the footnotes on the bottom of your Bible, you'll see here it says, another way to phrase the sentence is to say, to the saints in the land, the excellent one is in whom is all my delight, I say. Meaning he's addressing kind of a group of people that he's writing to. And this group of people is the people of God. He's addressing them and he's saying, hey, I'm going to give you a line of wisdom here. And I want you to understand that there's two groups of people that he's referring to. And so he's speaking to these people who are following God, who are praying to God, God, preserve me, that I'm taking refuge in you. And he's saying to them, hey, I'm going to give you a warning. And this is the warning in verse 4. He says, the sorrows of those who run after another God shall multiply. Their drink offerings of blood I will not pour out or take their names on my lips. And essentially what he's saying is that, man, the one who seeks refuge in the things of the world, who runs to all the things in the world to find their hope and their meaning, he said their sorrows are just going to multiply over and over and over again. The sorrows of those who run after another God shall multiply. And so this phrase, and at the end where he says, their drink offerings of blood I will not pour out or take their names on my lips, is he's referring to the cult practices that these different groups of people would have in the Old Testament. And essentially he's just saying, like, don't go near it. Like, there's no value in entertaining or even trying to look in any way, shape, or form similar to running to the things of the world to find what you're supposed to find in God, which is, once again, this refuge that they're finding, that David is finding in God. He's saying, don't run to things of the world, because if you run to those things, you're gonna end up finding yourself disappointed, let down over and over and over again. Don't run to those things, and don't even associate with them in any way. And that's what that phrase there at the end means. So once again, he sets up this picture between then the ungodly, so those who are seeking wicked things, and those who are seeking God. And he's saying, man, if you are seeking the things of the world, your sorrows will be multiplied over and over again. But if you're seeking God in heaven and finding refuge in him, things change. And it leads then to what will be a perspective change. So let me just attach this real fast, because I just explained a lot of stuff and a lot of like interesting, weird, like Old Testament stuff. How does this fit into then New Year stuff? I think it fits in that one of the things that we need to pursue as we go into this next year is then this kind of this heart of, I think, humble prayer towards God. That we would, in one way, that we would come every single day to God and say, and cry out to God as we go into, whether it's your school or even if it's just the family situation that you're in right now, or maybe it's the set of friends that you're with or whatever is going on in your life, that you would walk into that aware of the fact that there's all these other things in the world that are potentially trying to draw you away from God, and going to God and saying, God, I'm going to humble myself right now and admit that I'm a weak person and I need your help. And so every single day saying, God, I'm coming to you because I need your help to be preserved, to be able to persevere, to be able to walk through and navigate through this next year in a way that honors you. I need your help to do that. And so that's where we start. And I think that's one of the things, like if we're gonna pursue and resolve to do anything in this next year, I think the most important thing, it's the most important and probably like the least thing given airtime to is simply just to pray, is to bring God into every single day, not just once, but multiple times over and over and over again. And so as David prays this, as he humbles himself before God, it then leads to what is our second point, I think, is a perspective change. So it leads to a different and a new perspective. And so in Psalm 16, verses 5-8, this is what it says. It says, the Lord is my chosen portion and my cup. You hold my lot. And so he's using this kind of food analogy here that's really interesting and I think is a way for us to understand, once again, to put it in real space and time, like who God is and what he is like. He says, the Lord, so Yahweh, is my chosen portion, meaning like, have you ever, guys, sorry if there's any like vegans in the room, so maybe my wife, like you ever had like filet mignons or like T-bone steaks or like a New York, yes, I'm getting one nod. Only one person's ever had steak, really. Man, do we need to like go out and get some more donuts and come back and get coffee so that you guys are dialed in? Yeah, there you go, steak. Okay, so there's good steak and then there's like McDonald's, right? Which it's like, is that steak? I don't know. It could be horse meat. Who knows? Like, and so, I'm just hearing someone say, ew. And so what is being said here when he's saying you're my chosen portion, it's this agricultural analogy where it's saying that like God is, Yahweh is like the best of the best. I don't know how to say it. There's like some kind of Wagyu or whatever it is. Yeah, it's like you can pay like thousands and thousands of dollars and it tastes amazing. And I hate to draw a comparison between God and a piece of meat, but like that's what he's talking about here. And he's saying like God is the chosen portion. He is the best of the best. There is nothing better than him. There is nothing greater than him. He is my chosen portion. And this says he is my cup. And this cup, the symbol of the cup is kind of this symbol, like you see it, I think we've heard it in scripture where it's like, my cup overflows. This idea of like, even when Jesus in the beginning of the Gospel of John, he goes to the wedding and he turns the water into the best wine and the people come out and they're like, what? Like, why did you save the best wine for last? And it's this idea that the cup is overflowing. It's the best of the best. It's the finest, most best aged wine or whatever drink it is. He's saying God is the best of the best. He's the chosen portion. He is my cup. He's the best. If I was on death row and I could only have one more meal, this is the thing that I would want. He's preaching to himself saying, this is who God is. He is the best of the best. There's nothing else that's better than him. And then it says, and then you hold my lot. And you're like, great, God holds parking lots. What is that supposed to mean? Like, once again, he's referring back to this Old Testament idea of when the nation of Israel, when they were going into the promised land, they were all the land was then split up between all the tribes and they were all given different kinds of land. And they argued and they fought over who would get the best land, because if you get the best land, then you can make the best food and the best crops and you can sell that. And it's then this thing of like, man, if I have good land, then I'm able to provide for my family, make money off of it. And he's saying that God then is the one that he holds our lot. In other words, our lives, like the plot of our lives, everything that we're gonna do in our lives, like he holds that in his hand. He's saying, you hold my lot, God. And then he goes on to say, and the lines that he's saying, like the territory lines, like the way that like things have shook out for me with God, the lines have fallen for me in pleasant places. Indeed, I have a beautiful inheritance. And this, it's this moment where like get this, like David's writing this in the middle of a difficult season, when he's discouraged and life is hard and he's calling himself to remember who God is. And despite the fact that his circumstances aren't maybe what he wants them to be, that doesn't change who God is or the circumstance or the reality that we live in with God. He's saying the lines have fallen for me in pleasant places. Indeed, I have a beautiful inheritance. I think it's on the screens here, but on I think in 1 Peter chapter 1, it's like verses 3 through 5, we hear a little bit more about this inheritance. It says, blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, according to his great mercy, which he has caused us to be born again to a living hope through the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead, to an inheritance that is imperishable, undefiled, and unfading, kept in heaven for you, who by God's power is being guarded through faith for our salvation, ready to be revealed in the last time. That's quite a mouthful of words. Look at verse 4. This is what God has saved us to an inheritance, same words, same idea, a beautiful inheritance that is imperishable, undefiled, unfading, meaning that this inheritance, this blessing that God has brought us into when we place faith in him is not something of this world that will grow moldy or that will grow out of fashion or really it's not even any of those things. It's not ever going to go bankrupt. It's never going to like die or pass away. It's imperishable, undefiled, and unfading, kept in heaven for you, guarded by God himself. David is saying in the middle of like the difficulty of what he's going through, that he's saying, it doesn't matter if I die. It doesn't matter if someone takes away every single thing in my life. Because I have faith in God, they cannot take away the most valuable thing in my life, which is God, my chosen portion and my cup. He's the one who holds my lot. So sure, the waves of life can crash upon me. The difficulty of life can come in. The seasons that don't make any sense. The frustration of not knowing what's next. That can happen over and over and over again. But it doesn't change who God is and his heart towards us. This is the perspective change that David is hoping that we would see in this. I think in this as well, like we need to see that this inheritance is clearly brought to us by someone. It's bought for us by Jesus, meaning it essentially is the gospel. It's the guarantee of what the gospel is, that it is that Jesus comes and dies for us, takes the punishment of our sin on himself, and then dies on the cross, putting an end to the power of sin, and resurrects, ascends to the Father, now once again seated at God's right hand, interceding for us, that through the rest of our lives that God would show his grace and his kindness towards us. That's part of the inheritance. That's part of what we get to enjoy on this side of heaven. Then when we breathe our last breath and we get to be with God in eternity, then we get to experience this inheritance in full. And so I think it's this kind of this big, it's almost like a really big rock that we drop in this pond of our lives. And we say like there's nothing bigger, there's nothing greater than this. That God is truly for, if we place faith in him, that God is truly for us, and he is our chosen portion and our cup. He is the one who holds my lot. Indeed, like it says, the lines have fallen for me in pleasant places. Indeed, I have a beautiful inheritance. That once again, nothing can change that truth and that reality about who God is. And so then it goes on, and once again we see this transition between the transcendent God who is above all things and then to the God who is near. So look at verses 7 and 8. He says, then I bless the Lord who gives me counsel, and in the night also my heart instructs me. I have set the Lord always before me because he is at my right hand. I shall not be shaken. Once again, he brings this huge big truth about who God is. And then he makes it practical. And he says, I bless the Lord, he gives me counsel. This word counsel, it's like advice. It's advice, or he disciplines us, meaning that he will intentionally bring something into our life so that it would cause us difficulty so that we could then grow and love him to a greater degree. And then in that, it says, in the night also my heart instructs me, which is just, it's such an interesting, if you think about that, you unpack that from our perspective, reading this passage of scripture from thousands of years later, we can see like he's probably talking about the Holy Spirit here. That God sends us the Holy Spirit who can then instruct our hearts in the middle of a season of difficulty so that we know how to follow God. And very practically, he says in verse 8, I've set the Lord always before me. Meaning he's saying like, this is what I'm resolving to do. I'm going to set God, like when you walk out of your bedroom, there's a door and you have to either, if the door's closed, you walk into it. If it's open, you walk through it. But in the same way, it's like, I'm setting the Lord before me always so that I'm always reminded as I walk through the different things of my life, that God is the one that I'm seeking after. I've set the Lord always before me. I've made this intentional habit of being with God. And because he is at my right hand, and the right hand is this image of strength, because God is at my right hand, because God is quite literally my strength, I shall not be shaken. Once again, going back to, man, like it doesn't matter. And like in a way, it does matter what's going on in life, because those things do matter. They have real like import to our lives now, and they're difficult and they make life frustrating. But he's saying, even though those things are going on, once again, it doesn't, because God is my strength, because he is with me, because he is who he is, and he's not going to change, because he is faithful and good and gracious and kind to me, I will not be shaken. And this phrase, I will not be shaken, comes up again in the Psalms over and over and over and over again. And what it's meaning is that it doesn't mean, once again, you say like, oh, we'll not be shaken, that means there's no difficulty in life, right? Like, no, like we, I think we obviously and clearly know, like, that's not the case. That's not what it's saying. What it's saying is that I will not, in a way that you can understand it, is that I'll not be shaken to the point of despair. Not so uprooted by what's going on in my life that I would say, like, there's no point in living anymore. He's saying, I will not be shaken because God is my foundation, and because nothing that's going on in my life changes who God is, I will not be shaken. And so I don't know if I have to go to, I don't think I need to spend all the time explaining how this is practical and important for our lives, but just to make it abundantly clear, I know for me, this is one of like the biggest struggles of my life, is I lose perspective. Like, if you've met me or if you've listened to me for 5 minutes while I've been on this stage, you probably know that I'm the kind of guy, like, I view life like the glass is definitely half empty. Like, that's just the way that I'm wired. It's not a good thing. It's a sinful thing. It's something that I have to like work against on a daily basis. Go ask Sophia. She will tell you about that as well. Perspective, like this perspective though, is like a slap across the face for me. As it should be for many of us, that man, like, gosh, like, how quick am I to forget what God has done or who he is? Maybe you even just came out of a difficult season and you're like 3 or 4 weeks into a new season and you've already forgotten like what God did, like, guilty as charged. I have done that. But this perspective change that we can have, like, this changes, especially as we go on into this new year. Like, we need to come back to this reality and remind ourselves, like, man, like, life is going to swirl and change around everything, but this doesn't change. Who God is and who has revealed himself to be doesn't change. He is the one thing that is unchanging in the middle of a world that can't even make up its mind about what color it wants to be. I mean, God is unchanging, and he is faithful, and his heart towards us is that he would show us his grace and his mercy. And that's the perspective that we need to keep on coming back to in the middle of our lives. I think very, very practically, it looks like us growing in a habit of gratitude. Like, I said it in the main service last week, and I think it's good enough to last another week, so I'll bring it out again. But, like, go back and write out the months of last year and then walk through all the things that God did and how he was faithful to you. I dare you. I challenge you. Double dog dare you. Like, if you come back and you're like, oh, like, God did nothing, I'm going to be like, are you breathing? Like, like, God has been really, really faithful to us. And yes, that means that, like, we are then sometimes very forgetful people. And the point is not to be like, wow, like, I'm a terrible person and I'm just so forgetful. The point is to see God. The point of the exercise, the point of the assignment is to view and to see who God is and what he has done, and to be reminded of that. And all of this then, it leads to what I think, or at least what I want to call like a new purpose. A purpose that God has for us. In Psalm 16, verses 9 through 11, it says this: therefore, my heart is glad, my whole being rejoices, my flesh also dwells secure. For you will not abandon my soul to Sheol, which means to death, or let your Holy One see corruption. You make known to me the path of life, and in your presence there is fullness of joy, and at your right hand are pleasures forevermore. And this is especially convicting for me because it says this purpose then that God gives to us as we then we stop for a moment. So maybe we're discouraged or we're not really sure what the next year brings. We stop, we humble ourselves, we pray, we remind ourselves of who God is, we remind ourselves of what he has done and how he is faithful and how he's been faithful to us in the past. It begins to slowly change our perspective. And then we see, okay, what's the next thing? What am I supposed to do next? And then it says, rejoice. It says rejoice, like this one part of this new purpose that God has given us. He says, therefore, my heart is glad. Like, yes, this is good. Like, my heart is glad. My whole being rejoices. Like, it's not just like a, like, it's so much more than that. It's your whole being rejoices. Why? Because my flesh also dwells secure. Meaning, man, once again, all this stuff is going on in my life, but I'm secure. I'm in the refuge of God, the God who preserves me, the God who is good, the God who, as it says in verse 10, will not abandon my soul or give up on me or just stop loving me because they had a change of their mind or because I'm not popular enough anymore. He's no, like, or he's not going to let any of his holy ones, meaning his people, see corruption, meaning that in the same way that Philippians 1:6 says that God will bring to completion the work that he has begun in us in Christ, that if we've placed faith in what Jesus has done for us on the cross, that God will finish what he has started in you. You might say, I'm too far gone. I've sinned too much. This past year was too much wandering. I don't see like any like pig dung on any of you guys right now, like the prodigal son. And so run back to Jesus. Like that's the image there. Like and in all of that, we can see like God is going to bring to completion the work that he's begun in us. He when he saved us, he knew that it would be difficult. He knew that we would trip and fall and stumble over our own feet again and again and again. And in that, he extends to us grace. And if we repent and we turn away from our sin and we confess to him, then he is faithful and just to forgive us and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. He gives us this new purpose. Once again, this purpose of being glad in him, rejoicing in him. And in verse 11, he says, you make known to me the path of life. This is then, friends, this is the path of life that we are to walk. Everything that we've just talked about is that in your presence, God, there is fullness of joy, and at your right hand are pleasures forevermore. Meaning that if we truly, truly want to change, like if we have, once again, like we're here at the beginning of a new year, maybe we've got some new resolutions, whatever it may be. The path to life, like the path maybe to becoming, to growing in our relationship with God. Like once again, all that change happens in our heart. And the way that we get to our heart is we humble ourselves before God. We remind ourselves of who God is and what he has done. And we sit in that and we wait until that truth changes our hearts and turns into gladness in our hearts. And then we find there that in Jesus, in a relationship with God, who actually wants to be in a relationship with us, that we find true and genuine real life. We find like actual joy and enjoyment in a relationship with God. And I know for some of you guys, you might be like, man, like I think about my relationship with God and glad and rejoicing and joyfulness are not words that I would associate with my relationship with God. I understand that. Like I get that. And in that, I want to encourage you, like, once again, like I would love to either me or your life group leader would love to have a conversation with you about that and to walk you through how we can get to this place where we actually are enjoying our relationship with God. And some of that means I think what I'm trying to say is like, I don't have enough time now in this moment to be able to unpack all of that in your heart. A lot of that's going to happen in the context of a relationship with another person who knows you and who's going to be able to help you to walk through some of those things. But I do know that it does start with humbling ourselves before God, praying to him, once again, looking to him to change our perspective and our heart and our mind, and then slowly beginning to enjoy him. And so very, very practically, here, you don't have to put it on the screen, but these are the three things that I want you to do, essentially walking out of this. One, I want to at least challenge you to pray. Challenge you to pray, either if you're like, I don't know what to pray, pray Psalm 16, verse 1. Preserve me, O God, for in you I take refuge. Commit to praying Psalm 16, 1, or just commit to pray some amount of prayer every single day. I think the second thing is to give thanks. Give thanks to God for what he has done for you. And over time, it might even feel disingenuous when you begin. But start the practice of giving thanks to God for all that he has done. And then the last thing would be, is what I would encourage you to do this year, is to spend time like with God. And that doesn't mean, like I know we have like the Bible reading plan and we have all those things, and those are very good tools, but they're tools. The Bible reading plan itself, by completing the Bible reading plan, is not going to make you a holier person. Like the Bible reading plan is a tool that you use to see who God is. And as you see who God is and you meditate on who he is and you apply that to your heart and to your life and you begin to actually see things change in your life, like that's what those tools are used for. It's not the reading plan in and of itself that's gonna change you. It's meeting the God who is in the Bible who's actually gonna change you. And so I wanna challenge you to say, hey, like what is your plan to spend time with God this year? If you don't have a Bible reading plan, like I said, we have one for you. Or if there's another one that you wanna do, I would encourage you to go and find that so that you can spend time with God this new year. And so those are a couple of things I just wanna put in front of you guys. A little bit, I think some of those thoughts, I'll just be totally honest, are partly unrefined. I mean, like I'm working through some of these things as well. And so let's just pray together real fast and then we'll head out that God would apply these things to our hearts and to our lives. Father in heaven, we're excited, even potentially anxious for what this next year holds. And we pray, Father, that you would quiet our hearts to take refuge in you, to find our security and our hope in you. Father, would you renew our perspective? Father, help us to see with clear eyes who you are and how good you've been to us. And would that lead then, Father, to joy, a new purpose in our hearts and our lives to seek you and to grow in our relationship with you. Father, we pray all these things in Christ's name. Amen. All right, just a reminder, Mississippi applications are due here in a couple of weeks, in about 2 weeks. And so if you haven't filled it out yet and you wanna go, I wanna encourage you to do that. But aside from that, thank you guys. You guys are dismissed. See you guys next week.